You're a K2 climber, huh?
This is unbelievable.
That one.
Manga Parbat. Yeah. Oh my god.
And then we'll show you K2, your destination, okay?
We're on our way in.
Yes, sir.
The doomed mission to climb one of the world's most challenging mountains.
Ill-fated expedition to the top of K2 was airlifted to safety today.
11 more than a quarter of the people who try to scale it die in the attempt.
Why did we split up?
Have actually perished on K2, one of the worst disasters in the history of mountaineering, and in particular on K2, which is the most dangerous mountain on Earth.
I think people are interested in trying to know what actually happened that day. 8,000 meters, you're in the death zone. There is a struggle, there is a fight in every breath, in every thought. Everything hurts, every limb, every cell is screaming, oxygen, oxygen, oxygen. You don't feel the cold anymore. You don't think the same way. You don't know if you're dreaming or if it's real. Time seems to stand still. Sometimes things go wrong, you know? But the question you should ask yourself, what would you do?
It's good to be back here, and it's nice to wake up to this sight this morning. It's my belief that everybody has a love of climbing. You know, the first thing a child wants to do is climb something. The art of rock climbing is relearning what you knew intuitively as a child.
You get such a big respect for this mountain and all the climbers who did it before you. If you want to have a nice story on the birthday parties, you know, you climb Everest. But K2 is really, I think, for the real mountaineers.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Good.
Pretty good view, I reckon. I think it's pretty hard to beat, actually.
There is quite different between people from Himalaya and from Western world. It's quite different because the Western people, they are more adventurer. They love more adventure. Our people also like adventure, but they love climbing.
Where are we?
Oh, we are now climbing K2.
All right.
Yes.
Il primo in vetta al K2 è di questa valle qua. Achille e compagnoni, per cui il K2 è mezza, metà nostra.
Everything is raw. It's glaciers,
its black mountains. It fills you with respect. K2 is absolutely the king.
You higher it gets, the more interesting it gets. So when it comes to climbing 8,000 meter peaks, you want to do it, but at the same time you have this fear. This is serious. This is for real. If you make one step wrong, you're history.
Finally here. Such a relief.
Fantastic job.
Good job. Let's get this tents up, the stoves going, and prepare for tonight. Good?
Yes.
For 3 months we were on this expedition. So when we reached Camp 4, it was already a magic moment. The whole earth, you know, is beside you. And then you look behind you, you see another mountain. And that's K2, it's a mountain on a mountain. Jer was coming, I was filming, I was asking Jer how are you feeling. And you know, he was almost crying.
So happy to be here. I was crying. 4-6. Okay, let's get here. Here we are now. That's wonderful.
You could hear his voice, you know. It's something what we already achieved, you know. It's already something. That's what he said. We had a brilliant night. There were no clouds. There was nothing. And then we went to the summit.
Afraid?
No.
No?
I am.
No.
I'm scared to death.
No, take out in there, you're a cop.
We felt overall like this was our day. So we moved up along the slopes above 4. Fred and I started out a little more slowly. Both of us felt really strong, very positive.
There were perfect conditions. I mean, we're talking about day in a million. There wasn't a day like this that I can remember, because it was warm.
Starting to get light enough to see the route up ahead, looking up, seeing a tightly spaced group of climbers moving extremely slowly.
They're not moving. What are they doing?
We are way back in time. We are really late. I don't know what the fuck we're gonna do.
Pretty disappointing.
I was so devastated. You put in so much effort for months, and then you just realize that there's no way that we're gonna be able to summit and come back down in daylight. We just went down. It was simple as that.
Many of the other climbers there had been on Everest or other 8,000ers before K2. I hadn't been higher than 6,200. I just wanted to come along to see how high I could get. When we finally got to the bottleneck, there's actually a traffic jam. Serac was the main danger. It's probably almost 100 meters high, slightly overhanging, and it could crack any time.
This very, very delicate place is notorious. Ice can drop at any time. It's a Russian roulette. That's what it is.
The main tactic to avoid the dangers of the Serac is to be fast, to minimize the time when you're exposed to it. It was not with a good feeling waiting there.
Ahí sí que se podían poner tornillos de hielo, bien. Y de qué maneras estaba escalando, poniendo todo el peso en la cuerda y la cuerda tirando de los tornillos, quizás era un poco, me daba.
Above 8,000, you can only trust yourself. I wanted to traverse out to the right to have a rest outside of the fixed ropes. It's exhausting to be in a queue, to wait. You can't climb in your own pace. Several others also wanted to wait there until people had passed.
The bigger the chain, the bigger the chance that there is somebody in this chain who is, you know, making a mistake.
Dren, he unclipped his rope, tried to pass me.
We were all shocked when he fell, but when he stopped, he stood up and waved. So we thought he was fine.
He's standing up. He's okay. But then we saw him falling again and sliding further down.
You know, right there at the edge.
Yeah.
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 What's happening?
What do you see? Yeah, steering, this is Eric, Camp 4. Over.
I picked up my camera and I zoomed in, trying to find him, locate him. How can someone fall at this perfect day? No wind, it's bright, it's great. How is it possible?
Searing, I understood that you and Pemba are climbing. Are you in the lead, and has there been an accident? Over.
Is he in the rock?
He's here. There is the rock.
Yeah.
The rock. Down.
Yeah.
Down this.
Yeah. Searing says he's moving.
Wow. He's still alive. We have to do something.
Is everybody coming down? That's the question.
Searing, do you know if everyone is coming down at this point? Over.
This is a plane down there, helping this guy rescue.
Of course, we had a discussion. Should we turn around, you know, to try to help? We talked about it, and then we said, listen, the Serbian guys are going down. You know, the Americans are there, you know. I think it doesn't make sense, you know, to go down.
There is not a big conversation each other about the accident. After 3-4 minutes, they start climbing again.
I was like, I'm gonna save this guy. I'm gonna save him. There's no way he's gonna die. Not this day. No way. It's not gonna happen. I just shoot up.
He hit on the rock, lose control, keep falling for 200 more meters and stopped. And I started coming down. There were maybe two guys below me, so I came down pretty fast. Maybe 10 minutes, he was wrapped in rope and just giving no sign of life. Already very pale and gray. Cuts on the head, black nose broken, blood from mouth.
Finished.
Totally finished, yeah. Almost.
If I knew that Dren was dead, I would not have gone up. The Serbians, they want to take him down to base camp. I said that that's impossible. What we can do is that we can at least bring him down to camp 4 and give him a proper burial there. 8,000 meters, you're in the death zone. Every step is a burden. But when you have a dead body, it's a hell of a load.
Okay, we have to go down like this, guys.
You have to stay
not so close.
Yes.
If you do fall, you release, okay? It's our lives too, okay? Yeah. Remember.
Jian Beg from Pakistan suddenly started acting really weird. He's coming down on my right side, holding on to the rope, which goes around my lower legs. And we are crying out.
Release the rope! Release the rope!
He did not make one single move to stop his fall.
Jesus Christ.
Instead, he just let go. And it shoots off like a rocket straight out to the open air and just disappears.
If you climb on K2, it's very necessary that you have the right people in the team. You have to trust each other fully for 200%. Gerard said, hey, listen, it would be lovely if I can bring Pemba. And Pemba is a Sherpa. But a lot of people are thinking about a Sherpa that he's just an ordinary guy who's bringing up stuff up the mountain. But Pemba was a really a different guy. You know, he was a professional climber like we were.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Do we have boil in the bag rice?
Yeah, I can take care of it.
You know, yeah, it's the one thing that I'm concerned about is that Pemba mightn't be too used to freeze-dried food.
I never been here too, but every mountaineers and climbers, they have to see here too, and they just try to climb here too. That is all mountaineering, passion.
It was clear for me that Gerard would be part of this team. Because I found a good companion in Gerard. He was a climber who had the same ambitions as me. And then you are pushing the limits, you know, higher, and yeah, and then it ends up in the Himalaya.
Jair was new for me, but Wilco knew him before, so I know Wilco, so I trust him. It was very quickly clear that Jair was a very qualified climber.
2003, I was the expedition leader on Mount Everest. We had a small team. Jair had a huge passion, and he was full of energy. He knew how dangerous actually mountaineering was. He knew over 8,000 meters, it's not called death zone for nothing. Every blood cell in your body has been deprived of oxygen, which numbs your brain cells. Making logical decisions become harder. The longer that you're up at high altitude, the more prone you are to your whole body disintegrating from inside. It creates mucus, it creates fluids, it actually starts to swell the brain, the lungs, till eventually you won't survive. Within high-altitude mountaineering, there is an unwritten code. If it's a case that someone is dying and you know you're going to put your own life at risk, you should leave them.
This 8,000-meter stuff was alien to me at this point, so I was just following direction, you know. Descending path was in a bad way. It seemed to be moving exceptionally slowly and stopping to rest.
And when I saw the look on Pat's face, oh, shit.
I was getting pulmonary edema, cerebral edema, thrombosis. I was being deprived of oxygen, and I started to die.
There was no energy there, and more than a lack of energy, I think there was an awareness of a lack of energy, and I think there was also a knowledge that he knew that himself that he was in trouble.
Pemba Gelging, and in particular Jer, were the people that were encouraging me down. If my team members hadn't helped on that day, I may very well myself be encrusted onto the rocks of Mount Everest for eternity, never to come back home to see my family.
They say that the most important thing when you go climbing would be to select a good climbing partner or somebody that you're compatible with. I've been lucky, you know, really.
Is he in the rock?
Searing, do you know if everyone is coming down at this point? Over.
When the accident happened, Gerard was also asking, do we have time enough to reach the summit? Aren't we too late? And Pema said, no, we can just reach the summit. There is time enough. And then we said, okay, then this is the decision to move on. So we just moved on. Korean team ahead, then you have the Norwegian guys, then us in the middle with the Spanish guy in front.
Y seguí escalando. Y eso fue, pero ni esperar. Yo ya no vi a nadie más hasta bajar.
We were climbing, and then you see the first guy is reaching the summit, and then you think, please let it be the end, you know, because you are really completely, you know, exhausted.
Tirada de media hora, o así, pues yo sabía que estaba la cumbre esperándome. Estaba ya ganada la cumbre.
Alberto was kind of a mythic figure. So I didn't see Alberto close up at all until I met him when he was on his way down. And then I asked him how far it was. And he said, yeah, a little less than an hour.
The moment you realize that it is in your reach, you're going to feel that you're going to make it. It's only a matter of time to keep on going to reach the summit.
Maarten, we staan op de top van de K2!
Yeah!
Gerald, Cas, Pemba en ikzelf, over om 6 uur plaats.
Four guys of this expedition, you know. Half of the team was on the summit of K2.
We're on the summit of K2,
yo!
The light was exceptional brilliant, you know. You are at the end of the earth, heaven almost. You're thinking, you know, this is it, you know, it's over, we've done it.
There's definitely a place of extremes, but with those extremes comes extreme beauty. In many ways, those very extremes, they're addictive.
He phoned me, and I was lucky enough that the connection was made. He was elated. He told me everybody was feeling good, that no problem. And then, yeah, I was just hoping to hear from him. you know, 5 or 6 hours' time.
We were all very strong. We were normal talking. We didn't have problems with the altitude. We were feeling very good. We were having good moment on the summit, and now we are going down. Marco was coming up. He said, somebody has to take pictures of me. So I said, yeah, yeah, up, up, quickly, quickly.
Era ancora chiaro, non era buio, era ancora chiaro, però il sole scendeva, perché scende alle tue spalle.
Then you realize, fuck, we have to go down, you know? Now the surviving starts.
President McAleese has said her thoughts are with the family of a County Limerick man who is among 9 climbers missing and feared dead in the Himalayas.
Icefall on the world's second highest peak that may have killed as many as a dozen climbers.
As many as a dozen of them were caught out in a collapse of an ice ledge just beneath the summit.
Straddling the border of Pakistan and China, K2 is slightly smaller than Mount Everest, but its reputation has always been much larger.
And another Pakistani, a French national, and an Austrian are missing.
The summit on the Friday the 1st of August. I mean, come Saturday, the internet was rife with stories. We had the Frederick Strang story about her pulling bodies off the mountain. One of the climbers, an American guy, Nick Rice, had his blog up on the Sunday. And he said that Jer refused to come down the mountain. I mean, he said refused to come down the mountain. Anyone that knows Jer knew what Jer was about. Something wasn't right.
Someone might throw some comment out on their blog about what they think might be happening, or, you know, some rumor they heard, and not realizing, like, hey, we are waiting for our loved ones. We're hanging on every single word and even how it's written to get some kind of clue of what was going on.
Those guys are making big stories, even when the tragedy is still going on, actually, on the mountain.
So coming down, you're a bit clumsy. It's not a matter of...
It's always the same. The real heroes you don't hear. The stupid thing is, if we would have been successful, which we were, because we reached the summit, there was only such a small piece in the newspaper, you know? And now, because 11 climbers died, it went all over the world. Everybody wants to know how it was possible. What happened to us was just a matter of misfortune, you know? It was such a successful story till we went to the summit. We were the first expedition on the mountain. We had a beautiful time because everything was really organized. We had good food, we had good cooks, every detail was planned and organized.
We are a very strong team compared to other expeditions. We were putting all our fixed rope, everything we were doing by ourselves.
Bringing up those ropes to 8,000 meters, it's a hell of a job. First 4 till 5 weeks, every day fixing the ropes, 100 meter by 100 meter by 100 meter, and then going back, just by the rope, you know, going down to the base camp.
Camp 2, base camp over.
The snow conditions and the wind, weather conditions are also really bad for you. And maybe it's a good idea to postpone the project one day.
No, not possible. Here's Wilco.
We have to be ready in July. We want to quit this expedition the end of July because most of the accident happened in August. the humidity is getting bigger, you know, so more avalanche danger. We said, okay, we want to go the end of July. That was the plan. And we were ahead of schedule. And in that period, all the other teams were arriving. The Koreans.
Good luck.
Very, very cold. Very strong.
The Americans. The Serbian guys.
Resting in peace.
French guys.
Camp one is sleeping, my tent.
Perfect.
And the Norwegian team.
No, unfortunately not.
Yeah. There's a lot of different cultures up there. Sherpas from Nepal, high altitude porters from Pakistan. There were different approaches to the climbing. The South Koreans are the main big, like old style, big expedition. Sherpas, oxygen, a lot of rope, many camps.
Yeah. Beautiful day.
The Norwegian expedition, we were only four friends on a trip trying to climb K2.
Break out the whiskey, so
it's a good idea. I like whiskey.
There is that element of remoteness that I love. However, the bustle of base camp, I actually love it. Get to meet a lot of different cultures. Everyone is into the same thing, you know, everyone's there to climb. We ended up having a great time.
It was very quickly clear that Jer was a very qualified climber. And next to that, he is a very social boy, more social than the average climber.
To me, the most important thing for all of these expeditions is to have a good time and have a good laugh with your friends.
Jero visiting us a lot, and we visited them as well. And Jero and Rolf were friends. Both were the same kind of guys.
When I met Rolf in 2003, I felt that I met a soulmate. In 2005, we went to K2 to try to get to know the mountain. The most important thing wasn't to get to the summit. The most important thing for us was to come home with good health. We were there for 93 days. We only got to a little higher than Camp 3. So this time, I don't think we really thought that we were going to get to the summit. Of course, you have to want that, otherwise you won't make it. But it's so much that has to be right for it to happen.
What went wrong was the weather. For 3 weeks it was snowing, snowing, snowing. It was unbelievable. 80% chance of snow today. Wind, 8 kilometers, 8,000 meters.
He was ready to come home. He said to me, I can't wait to have a good meal and a glass of red wine. You know, he was kind of ready. It was 60 something days by that point. But if you get a weather window, you take it.
The end of July, the good weather came in. But then everybody wants to use this window. So he says, let's have a talk, you know, and let's try to work together.
300 rope for butternut. If we want to more safety, 400 rope we are fixing.
Couloir, we take 400 meters. Then the Italians got 200 meters for the traverse. So 600 meters is plenty enough.
Maybe we need more.
We don't need more.
I think 600 meters is plenty enough, I think.
No, 700 meters.
Seven. Okay, yeah. Kim says 700.
We had a lot of meetings because if we are working together, let's be clear, we are with a lot of people, we share all the workloads, and, you know, 80% chance that we will get to the summit without any problem.
First leading, second, help them, third, making the bamboos.
The ice crew.
I always saw the base camp meetings as a vital key to success. It was our chance to get together and do this as one team. Not South Koreans, Americans, Serbians, Dutch, as one team.
There is only one summit team?
Yeah.
From every group.
Question is also, who is climbing in front, you know?
We say, listen, every team gives his strongest climber, and that's the trail-breaking party.
Two good climber and one porter who carry
Fixed rope.
This team starts 1 or 2 hours before other member from Camp 4.
We were thinking if the strongest team, you know, going to this part and fixing the ropes through the bottleneck, we can just follow the ropes and go to the summit. So it's a really, really safe plan. I don't know if you're going to be a
summit. They were really focusing on the summit. Both Jer and Wilco were really had the summit in their eyes. You could see it.
There are always things you don't talk about and which you don't expect. And one thing was that the leader of the high altitude porters who are making breaking trail, I trust this guy completely. But what happened? He went ill. So no leader anymore.
High altitude porters or Sherpas, they are going to fix the rope, and the members from the Koreans, they are going to counter-check that rope, whether it is fixed properly or not.
The new plan was that a Korean leader, you know, he was the climbing leader of the big Korean team, he would check everything in Camp 4, but he didn't.
We have a plan, 12 o'clock, the first party should move. But 11 o'clock, a Korean climbing leader is still inside the tents, keep smoking. And then finally I said, no, now we have to do ourselves.
Sherpa, Pemba, el rostro de la cara de Pemba la recuerdo perfectamente en la noche. Una persona. Vamos, se notaba que estaba por encima del caos y de también queriendo saber quién era yo que había llegado en la noche, ¿no? Entonces le dije no, vengo solo y espero un poco a que para salir con vosotros.
The summit bid was delayed because people were wandering around, like, hey, where's the gear? Where's the equipment? Where's the rope?
We are way back in time. We are really late.
Very disappointing.
The high altitude porters, they're just starting to fixing the ropes. And Pemba was not that kind of leader who said, hey, listen, we are going to do it like this, you know?
Sorprendente que pusieran cuerdas en zonas que realmente no se necesita.
It's like 10 meters from the tents or something. There were ropes very, very early on.
Suddenly there's no more progression. People are just standing there waiting. They yell back that they're run out of rope.
We were thinking, in God's sake, how is this possible? The only thing you can do is going back, cut the ropes and bring it up. And that's what we did.
We were delayed with 2 hours. And that's too long. You can't catch up 2 hours on a summit bid. Even though there were perfect conditions,
in the death zone, you're just losing more energy.
Those people, they are too optimistic for the summit, and that's why they keep climbing. They forget so many things about the safety.
People think that we're mad. How can you continue if someone died? But if you drive a car, you see people crash, you see people die in traffic. Keep on driving, because you think it's not going to happen to you.
I see. Is he in the rock?
He's here.
Yeah.
The rock.
Yeah, right there at the edge. Yeah.
If everybody turned back after Serbian people fell down, then I think there was only one casualties on the mountain, instead of 11.
Good. But not a great day today. A hard day for me today.
Yes.
It was not a good day.
He said, you feel strong. You are strong, you go to the top with Lars. And I looked back many times, and every time I looked back, and if he was looking at me at the same time, he was like, thumbs up and keep on going.
I remember Jared warning us that when you get around the traverse, you will see the summit, and then you will get summit fever.
It's so hard to turn around, and it's so easy to just continue a little bit, just a half an hour, see.
Jeg venter på deg, Cecilia!
I could see Lars on the summit. He took Rolf's rabbit hat on and danced on the summit. We had just a few minutes, took pictures. Even in our most crazy dreams, we wouldn't have dreamt it to be that beautiful. With that shadow of K2 into China. Absolutely beautiful. I enjoyed the view, but the only thing that was in our head was like, we're not going to stay here for very long. We're going back. We have to get back to the ropes before it gets dark.
We're on the summit of K2, woohoo!
Yo, yo, yo!
The time passes by in a very strange fashion up there. What may feel like a couple of seconds could actually be a minute or vice versa. You know, it's very hard to tell.
When we ready to descend, and he saying, okay, now I don't want to take flags, camera, sat phone, everything you have to carry. I took everything.
You know that almost all the accidents in climbing happen on the way down, on the descent. You get exhausted, you relax, it gets dark. So that's a fact that every climber know. We caught up with Rolf further down.
He was so happy and congratulated us. And we decided to descend together, of course, down to the fixed ropes, slow but efficient.
It gets dark just 15 minutes after we get to the fixed ropes. So we put on our head torches. when Rolf gets there, I ask him if he wants to go first or if he wants me to go first.
He said, no. Lush, I go first. You look after my wife. Yeah, it's that. It's the last thing he said. Anything, but I felt it. The ground was shaking underneath me. The last thing I saw was Rolf's head torch moving. And then it was dark. You must think I'm crazy saying this, but suddenly I could hear his voice. And it was so strong. It was like saying, you have to get down.
Going down thinking, follow the lines, and there is camp 4. And in a few days, we would have big party with all the teams in the base camp. The problem is you are so exhausted, and you are not that concentrated, and everybody is going down in his own speed.
We reached the quarantine Sherpas and quarantine team. Everybody become together, regroup. We have only one option. We put all people together on one rope, then try to bring down together.
Looking up the mountain every hour, and we were monitoring our radios all the time, and we were getting more and more anxious about their safety. We see these headlamps and thinking, oh my god, they're not moving very fast. What's going on? We started feeling hopeless.
The quarantine completely stopped. It's impossible to bring them down with the same rope because they sit down.
The whole thing was a little bit stuck, so it was not totally clear. One moment you're not walking all together anymore, so you're a little bit separated, a few meters between you. Everybody is just descending.
We came at the point where the fixed rope should be, but it wasn't there. Marco was looking, I was searching, but we couldn't find it. I was convinced that this was the right way, but why wasn't the rope there? The only thing you think is we must be on the wrong side of the mountain or we must have lost the way.
Perché nella mia anima mi ha detto, Marco, fermati, stop, stop, stop. Istinto, ha detto, fermati. E ho chiamato Gerard, vieni qua. Stiamo qua, questa notte. È possibile che parte una grossa valanga. Fermi.
I expected by noon, the latest, to hear from them. And the phone rang when I was at lunch, and I thought it was him, but it was another friend. She was like, have you heard from Jerry yet? And I said, no, I'm really worried. And then I went home from lunch, got immediately on the internet, and the first thing was trouble on K2. First thing I thought of was, okay, when does the sun rise on K2? Because that's when they'll start moving again. And you know, how many more hours do they have out there?
Se dormi, sei morto. Quando ha sentito noi che gridavamo, che cantavamo, credo che Wilcom ha sentito le nostre voci e è venuto verso di noi e ci ha trovati.
We were not in a panic. We were just sitting. We were just, you know, yeah, wondering why we couldn't find the rope, but we were convinced that next morning, with the first light, we would find the rope again.
Descent is not a really big problem. I'm so much fixed in the descending that I don't really know who is in front of me or back of me. So only thing is I know that I see light, and I was coming closer to the light and I saw it was Hughes, the Frenchman.
Hey, Hughes.
Hey, Cass.
you go past. You're quicker than me.
I pass him, and I go on descending.
Take your time. Ellie, go.
And then I notice something is not okay with the rope. I keep on descending. Above 8,000 meters, you're fixed in your own descending. You don't realize what's going wrong on the mountain. Then I hear some noises. Oh no, he's falling. You don't really know what to do. And I go on descending.
We keep descent together. They are moving very slowly. And then me and the Korean Sherpa, we decide to keep descent until the gully. When we reach there, I see the avalanche wash down everything. There is nothing, no rope, no anchors, nothing. We are thinking what to do now. It's still danger to stay there. Then we decide, okay, keep descent.
There is nothing. No ice anchor, no rock anchor, no fixed line, nothing.
Then I tried to contact with the Korean Sherpa, but I couldn't get them on radio because nobody switches on radio. It's a big problem.
We could go up. It was still nice and clear. We could see some of the climbers on the top of the Serac.
We were convinced that with the first light, we would find the rope again. What was going to the right, you know, to have a look over there. I was going to the left to have a look over there. Marco was looking somewhere. We couldn't find it. And then I start to realize that I got problems with my view. I was getting more in panic, you know, because I knew, fuck. Getting snow blind at this altitude is finished. No helicopter are coming, the guys can't do something with a body of 80 kilos, it's finished. So I said, listen guys, I have to go down. So I started just going down, without thinking anymore, just going down.
Just one question, here is base camp Serbian calling. Do you know some information about Gerald, the Irish guy from Norit expedition?
What I was hearing is Jimmy, but Jamik and Pasang in trouble. They were the Korean Sherpas. Yes. And then Rolf and then Pren Maldik.
I didn't even understand that other people had died, really. I was in shock. I remember a phone call I had to my father-in-law. I was so scared to make that phone call. I was gonna be mad at me. For not looking after his son. But instead he said, you have to get off the mountain, you have to come home. Yeah. I didn't only lose my husband, but I lost of course, my best friend. And my future, like I was hoping it would be.
I was just climbing down, and then suddenly those Koreans were hanging over there. I was just thinking, what the hell are they doing here? I didn't understand anything about it. Some spare gloves, so I gave the gloves. I didn't ask what happened. Maybe they were hanging all night long. But at that time, I was just, you know, shocked about it. I said, listen, I have to go down because I'm starting to get snow blind. And he said, yeah, but help is also under the way, so go ahead.
I'll send help.
They are all up there by themselves. They're not moving anywhere. They're just sitting still, just waiting to get help.
The South Korean expedition leader, Kim, was arranging a rescue mission. But I just said, hey guys, they're not standing up, moving 1 meter. And you're telling me that I should go up there when the ice is still falling down? There's no fixed lines, there's no ropes. I mean, that is just insane.
This is not a guided tour. We cannot physically butt people off this mountain.
Then American team, they said, because we don't have enough manpower, we cannot go ourselves for rescue because physically we are also weak. Still, bottleneck is very dangerous. Then now we have to go down.
Copy that. Most of the people, they are moving from down, from camp four, moving down. Then,
किमले त अब रेस्क्यु जानु पर्छ भनेर चाहिँ अब हाम्रै पछिको जति पनि छ नि
अब उनीहरूले त्यही हो उसको निर्णय अनुसार चल्नु पर्ने अब हामी चाहिँ अब खासमा अब उसले त्यति पैसा दिएपछि उसले अब हाम्रो लाइफ नै किने जस्तो गर्ने व्यवहार चाहिँ हुँदो रहेछ उनीहरू
I was so thirsty, you know, and I knew I'm getting crazy in a few hours because when you don't have water at that altitude for such a long time, you won't survive it. I looked up and I saw that Marco and Gerard were with those Korean guys.
Which way?
That's it. Il climbing leader dei coreani. Ma era tutto rovinato di sangue, tutto il mio ricordo era in condizioni molto molto gravi. Poi io sono 15 anni che lavoro con un grosso elicottero a fare soccorso. E io ho pensato, vedendo tante persone nei soccorsi, ho pensato, è una brutta situazione questa, molto brutta.
I had to go down, down, down. Of course I was exhausted, but there was no other way, so I had to do it. I just went down without knowing, because I was just following the terrain.
Un lavoro abbiamo fatto assieme. Io ho trovato una radio, un walkie-talkie, sotto allo Sherpa. Ho parlato con qualcuno, non so chi era, chi ascoltava. Ho parlato, ho detto, dopo io parlo... Non parlo inglese, I speak Tarzan English, è un problema. Ho parlato alla radio, ho detto io sono Marco, sono al Seracco, c'è un problema, qualcuno deve salire, io sono stanco, non ce la faccio più. Perché poi Gerard è salito un pezzo, è andato su e non capivo più cosa faceva, se voleva calare ancora, non sapevo più. E io ho tolto la radio, ho parlato e poi ho cominciato a fare il traverso in discesa. Pensi a vivere, non guardi l'orologio, pensi a vivere, che devo vivere.
When someone leaves somebody for dead, they're thinking of their families at home, they're thinking of their survival. They've gone into this situation where they feel that everybody knows that if you die, you die. And they make that decision on that basis. Ger MacDonald was one guy I knew that couldn't actually make that decision. Ger did not have it in him to look in their eyes and to live at a later stage to say he did not do his best.
तबर दुई जनाले उसलाई लिएर क्याम्पमा आउनु न अनि त्यसपछि हामी सल्लाह गरेर
He is alive, but nobody's want to come with me. But everybody say now it's still dangerous. Then finally, I start climb again. He wearing a green down suit. I knew that is Marco. If I don't have oxygen, I cannot bring him down because I cannot carry him. After 10 minutes, Marco is trying to move and trying to talk with me.
Go ahead, Pasang.
They said we see Korean Sherpas and Korean team. Now we're trying to descend together.
Down suit ko collar che kasto raicha.
When they said, then I think that could be Jar. The person rolling down, then I reached there and I saw two Korean body. It's 10 meters far from two another Sherpa's body. I know the rucksack and boots and down suit.
Everybody wants to survive. Doesn't matter if you have a child or a wife at home.
Yeah. That was the last moment I saw Gerald and these other Koreans. But I don't know what happened with them.
Why are me surviving?
Yeah,
it's just a matter of stupid, be unlucky on the wrong time, in the wrong place.
Wilco, our expedition leader, he's picked up with a helicopter because he's frozen his feet. And there's a second helicopter of Marco. He froze his hands really badly, so he can't use his hands to get the ropes anymore.
Most challenging mountains. Italian Marco Confortola was rescued from K2 nearly 5 days after an avalanche swept some climbers away K2 and stranded
weak
others.
And badly frostbitten from trying to help save others in the group. Instinct, he says, makes you want to do
Confortola that. Confortola says the expedition was plagued by inexperience and poor equipment. He says some ropes and spikes easily broke.
Different people were saying different things. There was a lot of confusion, there was a lot of stories, but the Marco story became the story.
Eravamo qua tutti preparati, tutta gente che comunque alpinisti, non erano qui delle persone perché si sapeva cosa si andava a fare, il K2, la montagna più difficile.
This guy had a horrific experience up there. He was in pretty bad shape, both mentally and physically. I said, look, I need to find out for sure, you know, what went on up here. Like, you know, I have to go to Pakistan.
It was really frightening because we didn't know what we were going in for. And I mean, I guess half of me kind of still believed Joe was alive and the other half didn't believe it. The following day, we got to meet Wilco and Kaz.
Fall. I'm sorry, I'm just totally in denial. But he's saying he saw your fall and his story of hope there. My heart, there was still hope. I know it's ridiculous.
Yes, I understand.
he is dead.
Yes, for sure. That's because that was what Marco told us directly.
Wilco and Kaz, they were obviously nervous because our brother had died, you know, and they were alive.
Why did we split up? Why didn't we look to each other? The only explanation is because we were too long at high altitude.
Marco's account was he was sitting there with Jer, and then there were three people ahead of him, and all of a sudden those people disappeared. And so they took such a fright, they decided, let's just sit here and wait until daylight, right? And then he says you came along, but then...
No, that's not correct, because we started together.
So you bivouacked all together, never came along later.
No.
They had their information about the little bit Wilco could remember and the little bit Kaz could remember and what they heard Marco could remember. And they drew a map for us, you know, the terrain, where they thought things occurred.
Marco is a very emotional boy. He's
yes, and he's totally confused. Also, at the end of, he was so tired.
They didn't know anymore. Kaz and Wilco had been airlifted off the mountain. There was no debriefing with the remainder of the team. And they actually didn't know. It was just getting more and more confused. We needed more, you know what I mean? It wasn't enough. For some reason, we felt we needed to talk to Pimba.
Marco had left by the time we got there, but Pemba and the rest of the Norit team were hiking out. And that takes a few days.
Also mentally, psychologically, Marcos is almost mad.
Yeah.
Because when I trying to give oxygen, he's annoying with me. Why you came here to pick up me? He's always talking negative, always crying. And he said, you are fucking guys, why you come here to pick up me?
Yeah.
That is
understanding. We say head case.
Yeah.
By the time Pemba got to Islamabad, Marco was gone and all the major news people left too. It never occurred to them that maybe he'd have something to say.
Quello che abbiamo fatto è fatto perché c'era nel sangue.
nel nostro modo di vivere, viviamo di quello. E quello che è successo sul K2, anche il discorso del soccorso che io ho tentato per 3 ore, più 4 ore, di dare una mano a questi ragazzi qua, è una cosa che è venuta dal cuore. Dopo, logicamente, con questo ha avuto le conseguenze mie, perché stare...
What Marco did on the mountain, nobody can take that away from him. He was a hero on the mountain. And I mean, the family always, to this day, the family have said, Marco did what he could do, he was a hero. But the stories were changing from Marco, from what he originally came up with. He said that Ger was out of his head, that Ger abandoned him. Within a day or two, the stories were rife in the papers. Marco was the last living witness to have seen Ger. So for to hear these stories that Ger was out of his head, he was hallucinating, his body was splattered all over the mountain. This was heartbreaking for us, like.
He changed his story several times, which certainly didn't help make things clear. And you know, his story had a lot of clout because everyone else was gone. Everyone else had perished. So you can say whatever you want. There's no one there to contradict what you say, except for Pemba.
See, all we have is a story to King Anta, and now all the stories are different, and it's very hard, you know? Every story is different, and that's all we have with nobody.
But why we are asking, because now what your story says is that you were a little bit lower than the body of Jiraj.
Two fresh shepherds forcing by the Kulin leader, rich Kulin, just a top section of the cooler, and then they are descending together.
I thought they were already dead, the three who were hanged, but probably they have been moving. And
yeah, then same time, three, four times Serac fell down, multi times Serac.
Pimba was the missing piece of the jigsaw. He held the key to a lot of people's questions. Ger had given his camera to Pemba at the summit. So Pemba had Ger's camera coming down along. And he continued to take pictures of what was happening. It was obvious then why Ger refused to come down the mountain. There was people in trouble. Ger was never going to leave him after him.
Would have destroyed him to just leave the Koreans. It would have ate away and it would have haunted him day and night, I think.
At first, we weren't told that Jared had gone back up. That came out a little bit later. Jared was true to his nature to the very end. That's who he was.
In our own team, we would have done everything for each other. But what did Gerard, not only in his own team, he fight for his life and even for the life of the Koreans. It's hard to explain, but as mountaineers, we understand, you know, that we are taking risks. And if there is an accident, yeah, we know that we have to live with it. If there is a heaven, we will meet each other in the future. We will laugh about it and we say, but we did it, you know? We did it.
Oftentimes, when somebody does lose life, what went on is held, you know, up under the microscope. Some people might say, they should have done this and they shouldn't have done that. Just because you survive a mountain doesn't make you an expert, and I don't think it gives you any right to say that somebody made a mistake, you know, because you just, you know, when you weren't there, you don't know. Only the mountain knows.
Thought that in July that we could buy the months in May and the time for the lines I could make. sentient spray is where you lay so peacefully like a stone. Sown by land and sea, red from red to brown, from brown to gold. Now to view, still the sun is beating down onto your body, like the sun rose out the dew. Oh, if we ever meet again, I won't be sorry, won't even worry, won't even care. Just as long as you can make it out, you'll be there. Oh, that's right.
Stay with us here on BBC Four. We're heading out in the footsteps of another of the last great explorers with Neil Oliver next. And then we join Ray Mears on a walkabout down under at 20 past 11 with a trip to incredible Kimberley.